Hello, gang. It's Wednesday, the 30th of March, 2016. Welcome to United Kingdom Talk Live, boys and girls, live. Yet another television spectacular for you. Now, there might be today, I think, one or two people who might have thought they were about to join one of our live karaoke shows. If there are, you might be disappointed. I'm sorry. It's just little old me. This is something else I do. Okay. We do quite a few different little things and bits and pieces and what have you. And this is a little talk show that I do now and again. Oh, we got a call already. Blimey, I haven't even started yet. Let's go to the call. Hello, who's that on line at 7500? Hello.
Hello, it's me.
Oh, good afternoon. It's Irish Mary. How are you, Mary?
I'm grand, loving yourself.
You're quick on the old phone tonight. Are you just trying to get a call in quickly before you go to sleep? Is that what it is?
Well, I kind of slept this afternoon.
Because you know some people, they do watch this show or listen to this show to help them actually fall asleep. That's the reason they do it.
So, how are you feeling?
How am I feeling? You are ringing up to find out about my colonoscopy today, aren't you?
Yeah, you went for it, and I'm so proud of you.
You know, it was nowhere near as bad as I had a feeling it was going to be. Now, let me just say hello to a few people who are joining us today. I like to say hello to people who are just joining us. Kelly up north, hello Kelly. Yourself, Mary. Hello to Jerry. Joe is with us. Vectis is with us. Shania, Ben, who did the quiz. I hope the quiz went all right tonight, Ben. For you, Ben was filling in at my quiz night tonight on the at the King's Head Theatre Bar. You see, Lord Mark Antony, who joins us now. I've got to tell you, that's my window cleaner. That's my window cleaner. He only lives three doors down. What are you doing here? Now he would have been up a ladder looking into this little room before. Oh, someone else is trying to call in. I can only take one call at a time, my darling, all right? So you need to wait till I've finished with chatting away to lovely Mary and then call back, all right? Because I can only do one call at a time. Yeah, Mark, he would have been sort of up a ladder before, looking in this window where the studio is, wondering what the hell goes on in here. Well, now he knows. Now he knows. We sit here for hours on end talking to ourselves. It's true. Hello to Craig as well. Craig Guy is with us. Hello, Guy. My nephew Jimmy Butler's there as well.
Oh, hello, Jimmy.
Say hello to Jimmy. Yeah, he's going on his first lad's holiday in June or July.
Where?
I dare to tell you, Ayanapa.
Oh God.
Oh my God, they all go there, don't they?
Well, Mikey's going to Barcelona.
A Barcelona,
da, 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 the end of June Barcelona. For a week with the boys from school. Right. All here.
But is it? How old is he?
He'll be 18 on the 28th of June.
Oh, right. So very similar. That's his first holiday, yeah. On his own, is it, or what?
It'll be his first time away without his mother.
Oh, you're worried.
But apart from school trips.
I was considering going out to Ayanapa myself and trying to blend in with a crowd and keep an eye, but I don't think I'm going to be able to blend in somehow, do you?
Nah, not with those checks, boy. I mean,
who's that old git over there, it'd be? Got to say hello to Guy and Ash. Sean is with us. Hello, Ash. And Terry H. Danny's with us. Hello, Danny. And a few other bits and pieces. Johnny Key's there as well. And,
oh, hello,
Mark
Johnny
Anthony.
Key.
Hello to you all. Now, just before I tell you about today's colonoscopy procedure, I'll tell you that now. Other things coming up in the show today. I'm going to talk about my apple pies. My apple pies. Someone has asked for a little bit of advice on how to do Facebook Live videos and this sort of thing and Periscope. So I'll give you my thoughts, but you have to remember, I'm no expert. I'm just same as you, an amateur sitting here chatting away to the world. That's all I do. And newsreaders of the past, I've got a little story about that awful newsreader, Kay Burley. Do you like her, Mary? Kay Burley, do you know her?
Not really. I mean, I know her, but I don't know her personally.
No, not personally.
But I don't particularly like her.
No, no, she's not a favourite news person. She's as cold as ice. Anyway, we'll come on to that a bit later. Also got to say hello to Johnny Key just joining us. Paul Dow. Paul Dow's on a bit of a walking thing at the moment. He's counting steps. I think a fitness thing.
Oh, yeah.
And he's doing very well. I think he's up to 6,000 steps a day. I don't know what that is. I mean, do you have to wear a little gadget for that, Mary? I think you do, don't you?
I think you do. It's like being tagged.
Yeah. 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 That's fair enough. Oh, well.
Well, so, when you're from Camden, you know about those sort of things.
Camden, you know everything, Mary. That's it. Everything, my darling. James is here and Robert's here as well. And Mark says, once I get back to London, I'll pop into my karaoke. Well, you've got so many to choose from. So many to choose from, OK? So I shall now tell you about my colonoscopy today. Well, what is a colonoscopy? You're wondering for yourselves now. People all over the world at the moment tapping away into their thing. Well, basically, they put a camera up you. Yeah. Not down you, up you.
Yeah.
Now, I've had to have this because I keep blocking up. You know, now someone keeps trying to call. I can't take another call while I'm on a call.
Do you want me to get off the line?
No, 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 because we're still talking at the moment. So someone's trying to call from a mobile. You'll have to wait till we finish talking to Mary and then you can give us a call in after that, my darling, all right? Now, yes, I had to have this camera because I kept blocking up. Basically, you know, I'd go for a few days not being able to go, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then I'd be able to go and I would go for a while, okay? Just to put it into perspective like that. So they sent me, put me in a queue. This woman rung up and she said, hello, it's so-and-so from the Royal Free Hospital. You've been put in to do a colonoscopy. First of all, do you still want to go ahead with this? I said, well, no, not really, but the doctor thinks I should, so I will.
And my friend Mary thinks I should.
And my friend Mary told me as well that you should have one. So, okay. She said, we've got a long, long queue for this at the moment at the hospital. So we're sending it out to some of the private hospitals. Would you be prepared to go to a private hospital? So I said, yes, that's fine. No problem at all. So she said, okay, now here's a list of the hospital. And she gave me three hospitals. Just a minute. I don't think they're getting the message, that person who keeps calling in, honestly. She said, I'll give you the list of three or four hospitals and you can tell me which one you'd like to go to. I said, well, it's much to me. It doesn't matter where it is. Are they all sort of roughly in the same area? She said, well, they are really, yes. I said, well, that's fine. I said, whichever one comes up first. She said, okay, well, as you've told me that, you will get done fairly quickly. She said, someone will ring you in the next week. Okay. And, you know, within the next week, someone rang. And they said, OK, we can do you. And it was about 2 weeks time, which is very quick, very quick. Had I have waited for hospital, it could have been a few weeks. But there we are, 2 weeks. So that's fine. So we got to the day yesterday. I did already tell the story about trying to get hold of the special powder that you have to drink to clear yourself out. I don't know if you heard that story, did you?
No, I was concerned with other things.
Okay, well, don't worry. It doesn't matter. But I had a lot of trouble getting hold of this powder. One side didn't seem to know what the other side was doing either, you know. Eventually, I got hold of it by going to the consultant who sent me. And he wrote me out a prescription. That was yesterday, and I got it there and then. At 7 o'clock last night, I had to drink this stuff, right? Mm-hmm. There were two lots. One you have about 7 at night. And one at 6 in the morning. So I had it at 7 o'clock. At 8 o'clock, you start going. And it's like water.
I know. Okay?
It's not nice. It's like water. But that's fine. And you drink this stuff. It's like a lemony taste. I wouldn't say it's horrible. You have a couple of sips. You think, oh, that's not too bad. But then you look at the jug. And you've got to drink a whole bloody jug of this stuff. And you can't eat anything either. From 1 o'clock yesterday afternoon, I wasn't allowed to eat anything for 24 hours. But do you know what? The weirdest thing is, that didn't seem to be a problem. I don't know why. I didn't, like, feel really hungry. And when I got back from the consultant yesterday, I had a banging headache. I don't know why. My mate took us there and back, as he did today. And Really, I can only... It was very hot in the car. He likes it quite hot in the car. And I don't know what it was. That possibly and me kind of an underlying worry about the whole affair, yeah, you know.
Obviously.
Yeah, yeah. So I think that... Anyway, I went to bed for a couple of hours, got up just before 7, and I still had this damn headache. And I'm not one to get headaches, but I don't like to take pills, Mary. I never take pills, really. Except in the 90s, when it was going out raving. But I never take pills unless a doctor prescribes them. I don't have a paracetamol for anything that certain or anything. I just never do. So I put up with this headache at 7 o'clock and I started drinking this stuff. And by 8 o'clock, it starts coming out, right? That's
it's
okay.
It's like having, what's they call colonic irrigation.
Yeah, sort of. By 9:30, I would say it stopped. It stopped at 9:30. And so that was fine. So I stayed up watching a bit of telly and all that. I went to bed. I couldn't really sleep. I tell you, I got very cold last night. Would that be like a fear?
Yeah, because you haven't eaten anything.
Ah,
and,
yes.
You know, downstairs is completely clean. You know, the sun is practically shining out of your eyes.
Oh, Mary, please, dear, please.
Oh, sorry. I've had these things a couple of times, you know.
Yeah.
And you just feel like, oh, I feel clean now.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and then they have
to. Well, what's that got to do with being cold? So I went to bed. I couldn't really sleep, but I was relaxed and all that. Then I got up again and got 6 o'clock in the morning, started drinking that stuff again. And again, about an hour later, it started sorting itself out. And then I suppose 6, 7, 8, about 9-ish, it stopped. And so I kind of just lay back on the settee and closed my eyes and had a little bit of a shut eye then. And then I had a shower and my mate picked me up at 12:15 in the afternoon. And we got there, around about 1:15 for 2 o'clock. So we're very early, but I like to be early. It was a lovely hospital, the Cavell, King's Oak and Cavell Hospital in, where is it now? Enfield. King's Oak and Cavell Hospital in Enfield. It's as we went in, it said Cavell. There were two sites, and we weren't sure which site it was. I thought it was the first, and Ronnie was convinced it was the second, and he was right, actually. And I think, to be honest, that is possibly the first time my best mate has been right in his entire life.
Oh, come
on. I can't. I think it probably is. You know, usually I'm 100% right, but on this one occasion, he was right.
Of course he was.
So we went in there, parked up the car. And I've hardly said anything to him on the way there. I think, you know, I kind of try and switch off, if you see what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
So checked in, lovely girls in the reception, and you knew it was a private hospital. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was nice waiting area, nice and quiet. Everything was very nice. So I checked in, picked up the paper. I was due at 2 o'clock, but about 1:40, a nurse came and collected me. Lovely lady. She took me into one room, asked me a load of questions. What drugs are you on? This, that, and the other. They didn't ask about, they didn't ask about any condition that I might have.
Yeah.
They were just they probably can tell what you've got from the drugs that you have. So I read out the list of pills that I take and they were happy with that. Then I went somewhere else. Almost similar, very identical questions were asked in the second room.
Yeah.
And then they said, right, we'll talk about the sedation. And at which point I said, well, I don't really want any sedation. If at all, I can't help it. And they're like, right, okay then. What about some pain? What about some pain relief? And I said, no. What is the pain relief? I said. Oh, by the way, those of you sending messages, thanks very much. I will come back to those after we finish the little story, my darlings. All right. So keep sending them through, and I'll come back to those as soon as I finish the story. So I said, what is the pain relief? Well, it's a laughing gas. Do you know what that is? I said, well, I've got an idea. I've seen it on the telly, little canisters of stuff, where it's very similar to that. It would take a load of pain. Ladies having babies often have it.
Yes, I
said, so is it a mask? He said, you just put a mask on your face and you breathe it.
Yeah.
I said, oh, well, I said, no, I don't really fancy that. Can I try without? He said, yep, no problem at all. Right. He said, tell me honestly, what's it like without? And he looked at me, he said, I think you'll be fine. Okay, fine. Then let's try it without. I then went into another room where I got changed. I had to put a backless gown on.
Yeah.
And backless shorts. They had a hole where my bum was. I mean, some people wear those at certain clubs that I've seen before, to be honest. Awful things, dear. So I had these backless shorts on. And then I had a white dressing gown and these pair of really nice, like posh socks, I would say. Posh socks, yeah, with bits of foam on the bottom. So that was nice. While I was changing behind a curtain, another lad came in. And I got talking to him. He was 27. And I could tell he was really nervous. He was telling me that he was there because for years and years, he's had the opposite to me. So whereas I stopped going, he keeps going, and they're not sure why. They've done loads of blood tests, and this was like the last thing they want to do. And he'd been putting it off for years, and he was really nervous. So I did that. When someone younger comes to me, like I do, start doing the whole bloody dad thing, don't I? Oh well, you've got nothing to worry about, mate. Just have that some of that sedation. I said, what does that do? I said, well, it'll put you out. It won't knock you out, but you'll be sort of fairly happy and not quite know what's going on. I said, it's okay. So you having that? I said, no, I don't think I want that myself. But I think you should, because I wasn't that bothered. You know, the nurse says to me when she's doing these questions, are you anxious at all? And she looked at me, she says, you're not, are you? And I said, well, no, not really. I kind of switch things off in my head.
Yeah.
You know, if they're going to worry me, I switch them off. So I'm aware that it's going on. So that was it. Anyway, after talking to him and trying to reassure him, I was taken into another room. And this was the... It's not an operation, is it? It's a... What do they call it?
A procedure.
A procedure. Thanks, Mary. Yeah, it's a procedure. So they explained it. Oh, the consultant did say to me... I said to him, I said, before you tell me too much, I've got to tell you, I generally don't read up on things and I don't really want to know what you're going to do until you do it. Otherwise, I'll just sit there worrying. He said, yeah, that's no problem at all. He said, do I take it you don't really want to know about the risks either? And I said, no, not really. He said, fine, no problem. He said, but believe me, you'll be fine. Okay, that's all I need to hear. So I'm in there. I went into the room. And this hospital's spotless. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that I've been to NHS hospitals and they're dirty, but there's a completely different level, right? A different level. I was very lucky to go there and not have to pay for it because I did look this up. You know, sometimes if you go to the doctor and you might have a long wait, you can actually go somewhere and pay for that to be done. Well,
mm-hmm.
This would have cost me about £1,500 if I'd have had to pay for it. So, you know, quite a bit of money. On the other hand, if you've got the money and a doctor says to you, there's a 6-month waiting list, why not?
Exactly.
You know, why not? It puts you don't want all that 6 months of worrying.
Yeah, and that is what people do.
Yes.
They worry for all those months.
Oh,
and if you're offered it, take it.
Yeah.
And if there's something wrong and... You know, as I've always said to you, early diagnosis is everything.
Yeah.
Now, you and I both know there is nothing wrong with you. And sometimes we have to put up with the inconvenience of having a camera stuck somewhere or having your tit squished between plates to have a mammogram.
Yeah.
But the thing is, when you do something about it, that's when you're fine.
Yes. Yeah,
you'll be fine.
Oh, yeah. Tim wants to know, is it quiet? I don't think it's quiet, Tim. Is it quiet for anyone else? I can push it up a bit more if you want me to, people. Someone come back if it's a little bit quiet, if you could let us know and I'll push it up. It looks all right to me. I'm banging on at 4 on the old meter, but I can push it up to about 5, I suppose, without too much trouble. So
push
I've gone
it,
in the room.
It real good.
Oh, Wendy says it's fine. Yeah, Tim, if I remember, you thought it was quiet the other night as well. And you're the only one who's saying that, so I assume it's probably your end, mate. Okay. All right, mate. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Paul.
But listen, darling, I'm really proud of you that you went and had it done, because now you'll be able to sleep better tonight.
Oh, yes, yes. Yeah,
you know,
I've already had a couple of hours sleep this afternoon. Anyway, let's finish it off. So I went in the operating in the procedure room, and there were 4 people in there. There was the consultant that had been talking to me. Lovely chap. I don't know where he was from. He looked maybe Egyptian, somewhere like that. Lovely, lovely man. Lovely man. There was a nurse called Sharon. She was one of you lot, Mary. She was from the old Green Isle, from the Emerald Isle. And she did all the talking to me. You understand what I mean? All the time, she was right in my face, talking, saying nice things. Like, oh, you're doing really well.
I'm telling you exactly
you're
what
doing,
was going on.
Yeah, you're doing really well, Chris. You're doing fantastically and all this business. Yeah. There was another Irish lad in there. He was all right, but he weren't very talkative, that one. It was like, I wasn't sure that he wanted to be in the room, to be honest, right? And there was another boy. Anyone under 35 is a boy to me now. Do you know what I mean? There was another boy in there about
25 is a boy to me.
About 28, 30 he was. He was from the Philippines. Again, very, very nice. Yeah. And him and the Irish nurse spent most of their time holding my hand.
Yeah.
And when I squeezed her too much, he took over. He could take the pain. She couldn't. So that's it. So I get up on the bed. First of all, I'm on my back. And because I decided not to have the
sedation
or painkiller, he'd already told me that occasionally he'd ask me to turn over either way, on my back, on my front, on my side, because the colon, where the camera's going, is all like bends.
Yeah.
I also found out at the end, some people are more bendy than others. You know, similar to our looks, we're all completely different inside. Yeah, okay, the heart is roughly in the same area, the lungs are there, but we're all a little bit different in our own ways.
Mm-hmm.
So off he went, and up went the camera, and immediately the nurse is talking, oh, wow, you've done really well, you know, because that's the first bit in. And it carried on. The whole procedure was about half an hour, which was a little bit longer than I thought it was going to be. It was about half an hour, and he told me it's going to be about half an hour altogether. Okay, right. And actually, he's pushing this thing round, not much feeling at all. The only time I got pain was when they put air in as well. Because what they have to do is pump air into you to blow it up a bit, and then the camera can move around and have a look.
Yeah.
And while this is going on, right, there is a TV screen in colour. There is a colour TV screen in front of you, and you can watch the entire... You are looking at the same screen that the surgeon, doctor is looking at as well. So that's fine. And I watched it for a while, and then I thought, well, you know, nothing to really see there.
I know myself inside and out now.
Yeah. Now, they did... on the when you go out, they give you a bit of paper, and there are 2 pictures on there. I did consider showing this to you all.
No.
But I'm not going to. I've decided not to now, unless you really, really want to. But I haven't got a bit of paper up here now anyway. So what they send you a picture of the inside of the bowel. If you're wondering what it looks like, it's very pink. It's very pink and little red veins and moist. That's the only way I can explain it, okay? It doesn't look horrible. There's nothing up there because you've been drinking this stuff, and that's completely cleared you out. All right.
And it would show up.
Yes. And
any
if
or anything like that.
Well, the thing is, if they find that it hasn't cleared out, they can't do it. You have to go, you have to go back again at another point. Did you know that? They can't, if they go up with a camera and you haven't cleared out properly, they simply can't do it. They have to stop and you have to go back again and try and clear out again because the camera can't see. You know, you've got stuff in, I suppose, it's like, you know, going into an old apple or something like that. You know, you can't see what's in there. Of course, there's a light on the camera as well, so it's all quite bright. It really is just like watching a colour TV show. Yeah.
Sorry for laughing. I'm just thinking of you and your Facebook karaoke stuff.
Yeah.
You know, where you need to get the right light in the right place.
Oh, yes. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you've got to get the lighting right.
Yeah.
That's why when I'm doing these karaoke live shows, when we do the, well, actually we carry the whole, almost the whole thing now, and the lights, sometimes people think that the lights are quite bright and they do need to be a little bit brighter just to give it a reasonable picture when people are watching on their computers and iPhones and things at home. Anyway, so it went on. As I say, the only time I really got, I never felt it until it got, I'm going to stand up here, until it got about here. And I felt something there. Really, it goes right up there.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of just below your left pec. Although most of my pecs are now covered in fat, I'm afraid. Mm-hmm. And I felt it there. But that actually didn't hurt. I thought, oh, I can feel that there. And I laughed, and she laughed as well. But there was a little bit of pain. In the whole half hour, I would say it hurt 5 times and for no more than 5 seconds each time.
And
the pain is
sedation.
The pain is when he fills you up with air to expand you a bit. That's where the pain is, right? And all you do, oh, that really hurts. Okay, I take some air out. He takes the air out, pain goes.
So how is the wind tonight?
Right. Well, wait. While it's happening, when I said, oh, it hurts, she said, if at any time you want to pass wind or anything like that, you go ahead and do that. She says, that's no problem at all, and it will relieve the pain. And a couple of times I was able to. And indeed, quite rightly, it did relieve the pain. It's only when the wind, the actual feeling of the camera going up, and it's that, you know, it's not a great big thick thing like a drain pipe or something like that. I suppose it's the thickness of a pen. If that, really, you know, it's not a big thing at all. The actual pushing that in, you barely notice it. It's not like, say you've got, you know, if you was to put a pen in your mouth and start scraping it around, you'd feel that. Well, you don't feel it. You honestly don't feel it. Then when it was all finished, he said, I'm going to take a couple of little samples. And while he's there, he said, I've got to tell you that we finished the examination now. I can find nothing wrong in here at all. This is all completely normal. There's not even polyps. Now, polyps are little things that can grow out the side of your bowel. But it was none of those either, because that's really what they were looking for, the polyps. Or at least that's what they told me. Maybe they were looking for something else, but they don't tell me that. So that's fine. There's no problem at all.
No, come on, man.
No, no problem at all.
My brother's, my father had bowel cancer.
Yeah.
My brothers and I have always been on this screening program.
Right.
We have regular colonoscopies. And, mine are all clear.
Yeah.
My brothers are all clear. Occasionally they find a little polyp.
Yes.
We are all clear.
Once you've had them, you have to keep going in to every couple of years for another one of these things, don't you?
Yeah, of course you do. Yeah.
So that's
fine. But look at how wonderful the system is.
Oh yes, it's brilliant.
Getting you showing up.
So he finished the thing, took the thing out. That was all fine. For some reason, I thought there'd be floods of mess and stuff, but there was nothing. There was nothing there at all, you know. And I laid back and what have you. Then they take me into recovery room. At which point, I'm handed over to another nurse. So I thanked everyone very much. And so the recovery room, and they said to her, okay, this is Chris Reardon. He's just had this, and he's had nothing, no sedation, nothing. She said, really?
Yeah.
And I said, yeah. I said, is it an unusual? She said, about 5% of people, only 5% of people decide to have nothing at all. And she said, he's done really well, really well. No problems whatsoever. And so that was that. So
you're a hero.
She then... She then took blood pressure, and they kept doing this, taking blood pressure and checking heart rate and all that business. So I did that. I was in the recovery room 10 to 15 minutes because, of course, I wasn't sedated. You know, yeah. I didn't have the problem. I was taken into another room where I was given a ploughman's cheese sandwich and had a cup of tea. And then I was discharged. And that sounds like a long time. The whole thing from being taken up from the reception area to leaving the hospital was a little under an hour and a half. And that's because I didn't have the sedation. And quite honestly, Mary, when I came out of there, I didn't feel like I'd had anything done. I didn't feel, that's hurting a bit, or you know, my bum's hurting. No, nothing. It was as if I hadn't had anything done at all.
Yeah.
And that was the whole idea for me, that I didn't want to have the sedation, because you do have that, and you're out for hours, and someone's got to stay with you, and something might go wrong.
Take home and make sure.
And I cannot...
24 hours.
I cannot praise that hospital enough for the kindness, the compassion, the friendliness, I cannot find a single fault wrong with that hospital, to be honest. I really can't. They were fantastic. The nurses, everyone was fantastic in there. And, you know, I got in the car and I thought, you know.
Whoa, what was I so worried about?
That's my story. All right, Mary?
Yeah, I love you, darling.
Lovely to talk to you, darling.
Soon. I better hang up and go to bed because...
All right.
Yeah, whatever.
Night, Mary. Bye-bye, darling. There we are. Mary on the phone there from London. And that was my little colonoscopy story today. So if you ever have to have anything like that done, don't worry. Honestly, don't worry too much about it, because it's fine. It really is fine. Would I advise you to or not to have the sedation? I don't know. It depends how you are. If you're anxious, then yes, I would say go and have it. But if not, don't worry about it. Just get it done. And I've told you when it's going to hurt. You know. And remember, I had that done at 2 o'clock this afternoon. 2 o'clock this afternoon. It's now 11:30. I'm sitting here. I don't feel anything. I don't feel any different at all. I don't feel anything has changed inside me or anything like that. Weird, isn't it? And even, you know, as I left the hospital, I just, you know, I wasn't even walking funny. I wasn't even walking funny. Was I anxious? Of course I was. But somehow, when I get into situations like this, I am, as I said at the beginning of the show, very much someone who can sometimes switch something off that's worrying me. And it's not too bad. Right, let's do some of your messages. I'm actually trying to get your messages up on... on the Facebook there. I don't know why I don't seem to be able to get those. They're on my little phone in front of me. But they seem to have disappeared somewhere. Maybe if I... Hang on, let me tap that and see. Oh, there we go. That's it. I can do that. Is that right? There we go. Okay, I'll go backwards with you. Oh, no, you want to go forwards with your messages, really, don't I? And I can read some of those out. Where do we start? Is it Paul? There we are, Paul. Oh, hang on. No, I'm going the wrong way here. Let's go back. Shania's with us as well today, Shania. I hope that informs you all of any little procedure you might have to have done there. Let's see. Let's go up a bit here. Johnny Key says, I bet Mary knows all about gadgets. Oh, she absolutely does. Oh, she's got them all, dear. Well, you know what? Someone gave me the other day, a lovely young lady called Sharon Stone. And she was at the karaoke the Tuesday before. And she gave me a tablet. I think it's Hawaii tablet or something like that. It didn't have a charger. She says, I want you to have this. She says, I don't want it anymore. Can you find a use for it? I said, well, I could use it at my quiz nights. So she's given me a tablet. How kind is that? So thank you very much, Sharon. That's much appreciated. Well, I must send you your SIM back that's in there. Okay, darling. I've gone back so far here. Let's have a look. There we are. Danny, let's see. Guy Phillips says he misses the Black Cap. We all do, Guy. The Black Cap is a pub that I worked at for 18 years. And, of course, I've met many, many other people as well. I was just a DJ. There were much more famous people than me working there in the form of drag queens. And it was closed last year, those of you that don't know. And it looks like it will be reopened. I don't know when. I would imagine quite soon a company has, and they're in discussions now on what to do with it. I don't think it'd be exclusively gay. They do want a couple of Black Cap nights, so to speak. I don't know what happened there. You can call in now, by the way, boys and girls, if you want to. A line is now free, 020-8144-3477. 020-8144-3477. Or, indeed, you can Skype in. I have a Skype. If you've got Skype, that's easy as well. United Kingdom Talk is the Skype username, all right? United Kingdom Talk. Danny says, I've got to have one. Danny, don't worry about it, Danny, honestly. Really, don't worry about it. Just go and have it done, and that's it. Don't read up on it, you know. I don't think people should be told all the risks sometimes. Because if you knew the risks about, proper risk about car driving or getting on a plane, you'd probably never get on one, would you? Mark says, absolutely agree with missing the Black Cap. Hopefully one day it will be like the Phoenix and rise back from the dead. Rise like a Phoenix. Out from the ashes, seeking love and adventure. Hello to Callum on the Isle of Wight. Hello, Callum. Yes, Mark. My best mate, Ron, came with me to the hospital and took me back, okay? But he didn't have to stay with us because I was quite normal. I mean, as soon as I got into the car for the way back, I felt completely normal again, okay? Johnny says it's a nice hospital. He had an MIR scan there earlier this year. It is really nice in there, isn't it, Johnny? And the staff are so nice. That's what got me, the lovely staff. Hello to Jane, Barbara West. Hello, Jane. All right. Wendy's with us. Hello, Wendy. Thank you for letting me know that the sound is fine. Hello to Dino, Paul. Johnny says, did you get a DVD? No, there was no DVD. But there is a... Do you want to see these pictures? Do you want me to go down and get them? I can go down and get the picture. It's nothing awful. It just shows you a bit of me insides. How would you like to say that you've seen inside Chris Reardon? You won't be the only ones, darling. Do you want me to? I will if you want me to. I'll go down and get them. Hello to Dawn Davidson. Hello, Dawn. Nice to see you, my darling. And Mandy's with us today. Aaron Alexander. Hello, Aaron. Aaron is a singer on a cruise ship. Very good friend of mine. He used to work in a bar with me. A few years ago now, actually, in Clapham, the two brewers in Clapham. So hello to Aaron, who's with us. I hope the boat work is going very well for you. Are you enjoying it on the cruise ships? I was offered a job on a cruise ship a couple of times, actually, Prince's Cruises. It's a few years ago now, but I turned it down. And the reason I turned it down was, at the moment, I have one, and it's always been like this. But let me count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I have 6 employers. Okay, so 6 different people pay me to do the jobs that I do. I would be swapping those 6 employers for one. Not good. So you see, if one of those 6 goes down, I've still got another 5. And I've still got 4. I've still got 3. Do you see what I mean? Don't put your eggs in one basket. There's a DJ, a very good friend of mine, who works with me at a certain place. And at the moment, he's got all his eggs in one basket. And it's always a precarious situation to be with. Doesn't matter how well you get on with whoever's running the place. Okay, they may be a fantastic person. You might have a row. You might have a row. He might leave. He or she might leave. Someone else comes in. Nope, sorry, I don't like you. And that has happened to this particular person. He was working somewhere else. Didn't get on with the new manager. Got rid of him. Now, what if that happens in a place where you work, where all your work is? Not a good move. You need to, ideal situation, one venue, one night. So you've got however many employers. And that's why I didn't take the job on Prince's Cruises a couple of times. Paul says Enfield does have good healthcare. Yeah, it really does. I mean, I cannot fault that hospital. Hello to Ronan. Your internet is not great. Oh, sorry about that. Wendy wants to see the pictures. Ben says, Chris, glad the procedure was carried out without any problems. Yeah, thank you, Colin. Much appreciated, Colin. I must say, Colin, they've asked us to do a little bit of DJing downstairs at the Quebec, but it's 3 o'clock in the morning, isn't it? I just don't want to work till 3 in the morning anymore. I've done it for years. I've worked till 4 in the morning. At one place, I worked till 5. I did that job for 2.5 years. It was in Brighton, and I used to do 2 a.m. till 5. I used to work at another place, 8 till 12, and I used to, in Hemel Hempstead, I used to drive from there to Brighton, got there about 5, timed it perfectly. If I sat on the motorway at 55 mile an hour, I would do it and always arrive bang on 5 to 2. Get there at 5 to 2, start, and then I finish at 5. I wouldn't be home till about 6:30. I just don't want to do those late nights at 2 o'clock maximum. Now and again, very rarely, I'll go till 3 o'clock. That's at the Two Brewers. Now and again on Thursdays, they go till 3 o'clock. But, I mean, really, that is the limit. That is the limit. I can't do a 3. I wouldn't want to do a regular 3 o'clock night. 2 o'clock is really my limit. Okay. Aaron's not on the boats anymore. Okay. Did you enjoy it, Aaron? I'm sure you... Can you come in and tell... I'm in the Two Brewers tomorrow night if you're around. I'd love to know your stories about your boat life. I bet you've got some stories to tell me there, haven't you, eh? Did you get chatted up a lot, dear? No? Oh, there's a surprise. Doesn't happen to me either anymore. Hello to Brandon, who says, hello, you old bag. I didn't get a notification. You were live. Well, you have to do a follow thing, I think. Brandon, I think some sort of follow thing. Paul says he keeps losing me. Think it might be you, Paul, actually. Sorry to tell you that, darling. I think it might be you, Paul, if you keep losing us. All right. So we can take some more calls now. 020-8144-3477 if you fancy. Give us a phone in. Wendy, do you keep losing me as well? I think people have got a little bit of a connection problem. I have not got any notices up here saying that it keeps going down, but we will carry on regardless. Now, I got a couple of messages when I put the... Thank you, Wendy. I got a couple of messages up when I put on earlier that we were going to do a late night phone in today. Thank you, Mandy. Mandy, whereabouts are you, darling? Are you over in... is it Penge, Mandy? I think you're over in Penge. Mandy's one of our wonderful karaoke singers. Yes, indeed. She does. Pearl's a singer. Da, 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 da. Ben, how did your quiz night go tonight? Don't suppose you want to call in and tell us, do you, Ben? You can if you want to. Isn't it funny? You know, all that time I was talking to Mary, there were people trying to call in. You can only take one call at a time. Now there's no one. They've all gone. I've been left. It's Mandy. Hello, Mandy. Penge. Is that posh in Penge? I'm not quite sure. Penge. I know. Now, where is it ISR drive through to go to Sydenham? There's one place. Might be Forest Hill or somewhere like that. I can't remember. Hello, who's I'll calling now?
Bonjour, Chris.
Bonjour.
How are you?
Qu'est-ce que c'est? Hello, Ben. Was that you trying to ring earlier?
Yeah.
Oh, right. Well, I was on another call, and you know I can only do one call at a time.
Yeah, I forgot how much Mary could talk.
Oh, of course, she goes on and on, dear. On and on. I mean, you know when she goes to church on Sundays, like myself, when she does hymns, she does extra verses, and everyone's telling her to be quiet, dear. How did your quiz night go tonight? All right?
It went very well. I left people missing you.
You did what?
I left people missing you.
Oh, were they missing me? No doubt you told them the whole story.
No, but one of the teams was convinced I was hiding my horns and tail.
Hiding your what?
Horns and tail.
What, you're a little devil, are you?
Yes.
Why? What did you do? How did the music round? Did you do the Gregorian chant for the music round tonight?
No, I didn't. I did Eurovision.
Oh, I thought you were going to do Gregorian chant.
I did, but I thought that would be too easy.
Oh, right. Okay.
Yes, they had to guess the year.
And how many teams did you get in tonight?
6.
So, oh, it was a bit quiet tonight then.
It was a bit quiet tonight, yeah. Yes.
I'm not surprised. The whole Easter thing has come and gone.
Hang on a second.
Can we get a large filet of fish meal with a large chocolate shake? Yeah. And a large quarter ham meal. No cheese,
and
a large strawberry shake.
It's all Daddy McDonald's.
No, that's it. No, don't check your order. Oh, that's...
Guess where I am.
Well, that's a bit of a liberty, isn't it? Ordering a McDonald's while you're calling into this worldwide television show. Everyone knows your stuff and your fat face now. And you're ordering that. You'll be the next one to have a colonoscopy, dear.
Well, I will on the 22nd of April.
Yeah, I know. Ben's got one booked as well. And have I managed to put your mind at rest? Because I've just told the whole story that I told you earlier privately.
Yes. Well, I was listening to Mary on the drive home.
Oh, were you? Okay. Yeah. Are you on the mobile phone, are you?
I was, yes.
Yeah, okay. What? Have you got another call coming in?
No, it's just a wife. Probably reminding me to get the McDonald's on the way home.
Oh, aren't you awful? Well, I'm glad you had a good night tonight. That's pleased me, that has. I knew you'd like it. Yeah. Isn't that a lovely place to be working, though?
It is. And my radio mic was on a different set of frequencies to theirs as well.
I've got three, but I always use the same one there, and I'm not quite sure what frequency the other one is on. Yeah. You know. Never mind. All right, Ben, well, have a nice night, mate.
You too, Chris.
Thanks for calling
in. I'll think of you while I'm eating my McDonald's.
You enjoy that. Oh, no, thank you. Rather you than me. I've got two lovely apple pies in the oven. Well, they're done now. They're just resting. They're resting.
Oh, lovely.
See you, Ben.
What are they, Aunt Bessie's?
No, one's pink lady apples and the other's bright. Oh, no, made from scratch, dear. We don't
buy. Made from scratch.
Now, here's the funny thing, right? So made from scratch apple pies cook quicker than a frozen one will.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
So why would you buy frozen? I can't work it out. Okay, it's a little bit messy peeling the stuff and all that, but, you know, I don't get it.
Oh.
See you, Ben.
See you, Chris.
Tell our mate. Thanks for calling. There we are. Ben, who did the karaoke for me earlier today. And another call coming in. Who's this, please? Hello?
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 Is this Mr. Reardon?
It is Mr. Reardon. Yeah, you need to turn off my video.
You're in front, yeah. How are you, darling?
I'm very well. Is that Paul?
Yeah.
I see. I know that deep, butch, gruff voice. How are you today, sir?
I'm tired. And as I was walking my heart went out of the room today, so I had to get home early.
Did you find you became more tired while I was doing my show? Because that often people use these programs.
I fell asleep.
Yeah, people do. People do use these programs when they have trouble falling asleep.
I was absolutely gobsmacked that you described everything that you had done. not many people blame enough to go.
No, I'm just trying to see. I'm just trying to see how many people.
Know what a colonoscopy
is. Wanted to see the pictures, and I think it's just Wendy who wants to see them.
So well, I think Wendy's a bit sort of, yeah.
I think like Wendy, that, Wendy wants to see the insides of me. you wouldn't know it, obviously. You don't know who it is. It's just a picture. You could look them up on the internet if you want to know what it looks
just
like.
Be very, like you say, very pink and really unrecognisable, really. It's just that place,
you know. Yeah, you don't know who it is. And it was all, you know, it's nothing really nasty in there, really.
Well, let me tell you what I've done today. I walked from London Bridge to Westminster Bridge along the South Bank.
Sorry, you went where?
London Bridge.
Yeah.
To Westminster Bridge along the South Bank. I got to 6,000 steps. I thought, I'm going to stop. And then carried on. So I actually done 7,500.
Oh, that's good. So how long are you out for? Rather than
about an hour and a half.
That's a decent walk, that is. Yeah.
It's a nice walk, you know.
That's a decent walk.
It's not 5 miles an hour or 10 miles an hour. It's only walking pace, you know. It's like 2 miles an hour. But
why are you doing this, Paul, as a matter of interest? Is it a fit thing?
I've got paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, which is an irregular heartbeat. Right. And it comes and goes, and it knocks me for six. And also, I'm such a borderline diabetic that I need to lose a bit of weight and get rid of this diabetes. So that's what I'm doing.
Okay.
Purely for health reasons, you know.
Have you managed to lose any yet?
I've lost about 5 kilos.
Oh, that's a good amount. Yeah, so people don't...
It does go, but it goes this is over a month, so you're only talking about £2 or £3 a week, you know.
Yeah, I don't think people realise how much a kilo is. It's a number of pounds, isn't it, a kilo?
Yeah. Well, I used to go to Slimming World.
Yeah.
They actually showed you a pound of fat, and it's quite grotesque.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And when you lose sort of like 56 of those, which is a half hundredweight in potatoes.
Yes.
Well, you know, like a bag of potatoes, you think, blimey, I was carrying that around, you know?
Yeah.
And the one reason I'm doing it is because I'm weighing too much. And it's a strain on my knees, it's a strain on my back, and it's, you know, but I can walk. That's one thing I can do. I mean, I don't have arthritis, which is a good thing, you know? So.
Yeah. I did some jogging for a while. I'm going back here about 3 years. And I stopped because my knees started playing up. Went to the doctor. First thing he said was, do you go jogging? Yes, I do. Okay, stop. He said, walk as far as you want.
Good walk. Good walk's good. Good. Be surprised.
That is exactly what he said. He said, the walking is almost as good as the jogging. That's what he said. Yeah. He said, walk. So
when
I did that.
When you jog, you actually push out the synovial fluid between your joints.
Yeah.
And then you rub together.
Yeah.
Which will be arthritis. When you walk, it's less strain on your knees and on the bits that hurt, you know?
I was going out every day, Paul, and I'd got up to about an hour and 15 minutes and was doing it every day, so no wonder I did my knees in. One of the jogs I did, it was the height of the summer, so very hot during the daytime, and I just finished DJing, actually, at the Two Brewers on a Thursday night.
Yeah.
And I've come out of there at 2 o'clock, and I thought, do you know what? And I wasn't tired. I'll go for a jog tonight. And I went over... Chelsea Bridge.
Yeah.
I parked just in front of the church there. Do you know, there's like a little church. On the embankment it is, right on the embankment, this church. And I parked up there, put on my running shoes, and I went running. And I went from Chelsea Bridge all the way down to Vauxhall Bridge. Bridge and come back the other way. And went back over Chelsea Bridge. So that is about an hour.
You've got such wide walkways.
Yes.
They're all very well maintained on the side of the side of the thing. So
yes.
It's quite good.
And, of course, that time of night, it certainly wasn't cold.
No.
I was sweating away, you know, by the time I got back. And I was so pleased with myself that I'd done that. And the reason I took up jogging those years ago is because I was going to go to Australia. And I had it in my mind... that I was going to go and be able to...
That is going to be fit.
I was going to be, apart from being fit, I was going to be able to go running down the beaches like they do on the telly. Now, so, you know, and I got to that stage. I got to that stage of being able to run for an hour, no problem at all.
Mm.
And I got to Australia and I thought, right, I'm going to do it anyway. So I got on the beach and I started running. Do you know how hard it is to run on sand? And I couldn't do it. I managed.
I say, like you, I'm at 26 years old. I used to run 20 miles a day.
Yes.
And I like going on. I like running on grass.
Right. Yeah.
The only time I ever run on tarmac is when the police were chasing me. That's the only time I really run.
Oh, you're not stealing again from that little Tesco's Express, are you?
No, I drive cars and without people's permission. And so I didn't steal them. I used to borrow them and never take them back, you know?
What's that? What did you used
when
to nick
that? I was a young lady.
What did you used to nick? Sweets?
Yeah, all sorts of things, yeah. Please, I'm not that person.
I bet your whole house is furnished with stolen items, isn't it?
Yeah, it is actually, yeah. I've just acquired a lock-up, you know, I'm a bit of a del boy, me, you know.
You sound like it.
Sorry?
You sound like it.
All right, now I've done Cockney rhyming slang, right? I'm for you, Chris. My plates of meat are really killing me, so I'm going to go and soak them in some water. What am I talking about? my plates really
feet,
hurt.
So your feet, soak... your feet.
Feet, well done.
Of course
Cockney
I know what that
slang.
Is.
Right,
of course
okay,
I know.
Then what's the skin then? What's the skin?
Skin? What? Say that again?
Skin. Skin. What is your skin? I've got two of them.
Skin.
One's older than me, one's younger. Skin and blister.
Sister.
Yeah, well, Dan, you didn't have that one, did you? You ain't going to cock me, though, are you?
Well, you only gave me half the bloody thing. You said skin.
Oh, well,
skin and blister.
Said,
sister.
Bit.
It's
right,
not hard. You just
right,
find somebody to rhyme
jar,
with it.
Then? What's your jam jar?
Car.
Yeah, well, okay. All right. Forsyth saga?
Oh.
You don't drink it, so you wouldn't know.
What is it then?
Forsyth Saga is lager.
Okay, yeah. No, I'm a non-drinker.
I've got to go because I actually do need a wee, so.
All right, Paul, lovely to talk to you.
Luck out of you, mate. I'll see you Monday,
yep,
all right?
Cheerio now. Bye-bye. There's Paul, mate. One of our karaoke singers. He often comes along Mondays and Fridays to the karaoke at Central Station. It's always very nice. Call in if you want to, boys and girls. How are we doing on time? We're in about an hour, yeah? We'll go till about 12:30, OK? 12:30 tonight, if you're still around. 020-8144-3477 is the phone number. 020-8144-3477. Vectis wants to know, can I come and have a portion of apple pie? You are welcome. Are you around here? I'd happily give you some of my apple pie to sample. And today I remembered, get this, I remembered to beat up an egg. Oh, yeah, I kicked the hell out of this thing. Kick this egg to pieces, I did. I beat up the egg and brushed it on top with my new little pastry brush that I purchased from Sainsbury's. No, was it? No, Waitrose. That I purchased from Waitrose. So I've got beaten up egg and it's all gone nice and glazed and brown colour on the top. Ronan's on the line. Do you like apple pie, Ronan?
I'm not really a fan, no.
Oh, really? Don't like apple pie?
No, I like apple crumble.
I was hoping to supply the airline that you work on, possibly with, you know, in the first class area, Chris Ridden's homemade apple pies. They'd see it and I know they'd want to try some.
It depends how many you can produce.
Well, I mean, would two pies be enough? You can probably get, looking at the portions you get on planes, two pies would, I reckon, be either 12... or 16 portions of apple pie. And you've got to put the ambrosia custard, none of that powdered stuff, dear. Ambrosia tinned custard, cold, on the top. Yes, please. Thank you very much. Wendy says it's lovely to hear you, Ronan.
Oh, thank you. If the internet goes, I'm in Prague at the moment, so it's quite...
Is that...
Yeah.
Czech? Is that Czech Republic?
Czech, yes.
Okay. You're working there, are you?
Yeah.
What is there to do in Prague? I don't know that.
I just one out and then one back.
Pardon?
Oh, it's my first time here.
Oh, right.
It's my first time here, so...
So have you been out anywhere?
Oh, no, because I only just got here, so...
Oh, what, literally now?
It was a late night. About an hour ago.
Oh, OK. Are you going to go out or tomorrow morning, maybe?
Tomorrow morning I'll be going out.
Have a little look around. Do you know where you're going, or have you got friends to take you?
Apparently there's a castle here, so I'll probably go and look at Targa Castle.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And that'll probably be it then.
And you come back tomorrow. Then go back. It's not like a stay over for three nights or anything like that.
No, I wish.
But you get that to the Caribbean, don't you?
Well, yeah, we get... What have I got for... After this, I've got Dubai, which is two nights. Well, it's two nights, and then... Dallas, which is two nights, and then two more
Dubai. Dallas! Oh, you must go and visit Southfork Castle and do a live report from there. Not where? Castle, it's, Southfork Ranch. Do you know what Southfork Ranch is?
Is that on Dallas, the
correct.
TV show?
Correct! That's one thing I would like to do that. Visit. Obviously, Dallas isn't on anymore, but I would like to visit Southfork Ranch on the way to Dallas. I was I was thinking... Maybe if Barry Manilow did a concert there, then I could go there and go and visit Southfork Ranch. I don't know what else there is to do at Dallas, though. I'm not sure.
JFK. You can see where JFK got shot.
Oh, have you been there yet?
Yeah, I've done all that.
Oh, go on. Tell me what there is to do in Dallas. I'm going to write this down.
So you can go to rodeos. Rodeos are massive.
Rodeos?
See where, like, the cowboys ride the horse and everything.
Right.
And bulls. And then you've got... There's a restaurant called Tally Records. It's the male version of Hooters.
Hooters, I know that one. That's where all the girls wear those really tight tops.
Yeah,
tight
it's called Tallywhackers.
Well, so looking at the amount of fat on my pecs at the moment, I'd probably pass as a Hooter waitress.
There's loads of... sort of, you can do loads of tours around the city centre.
Yes.
But it's only longer than a couple of days.
Right. You're breaking up quite a lot. Are you on the Skype?
Yes. I'll do it in a couple of moments when my internet really works and I can use my own internet.
That's pretty bad. Mandy says there's lovely food in Prague. Mandy, would you recommend a restaurant for my friend Ronan to go to? He works on one of the airlines.
I'll come back in a minute.
Travelling around at the moment, aren't you, my darling? So,
you're breaking up.
Oh, no, he's gone. We've lost him. Okay, I thought that was going to happen. The old Skype was breaking up there. Never mind. Lovely to talk to Ronan there. Let's have a look. Mandy says you need to have the procedure to get to the bottom of things. Well, I did. Vectis says, make some crumble. I would leave the Isle of Wight. Well, apple crumble. I can make apple crumbles. It was no different to the pie, really, except the top and on top, isn't it? Now, I was going to just read out a couple of the messages that people put on there when I said I was going to do the live. I wanted to answer someone. If I can remember what it was. Oh, yes. So, first of all, Terry H. Hello, Terry. I think you're still with us today, Terry. I know you was on there earlier. It might be getting part. Oh, there goes the clock. Did you hear that? It's just, you can't see it on there, can you? It just flicked over to March. It's now Thursday. Happy Thursday to you all, boys and girls. Happy Thursday. Terry and also Jerry Green said, I wish you would come on YouTube more often. I like your live shows on YouTube. It doesn't work very well on Facebook. I'm not sure. Can you be a little bit more specific there, Jerry? What is it you don't like about the Facebook Live? I'd like to know, please, mate. Okay, so if you'd tell us. It says it doesn't work very well on Facebook. I miss those Saturday shows on YouTube. The thing is with the Saturday shows, I did enjoy doing them, of course, but I found them a bit restrictive. I had to be in the same place all the time, 11 o'clock, Saturday morning, and, or was it 12? I can't remember even now. Was it 12 or 11? Something like that. 12 or 11, I think it was. And that was it. And it restricted me. I'd lose Saturday. I'd lose Saturday. So that's why I don't do a regular Saturday morning, afternoon show anymore. I just come on Facebook now and again and we just do one live as and when. About an hour and I'm like, I'll do a little show. I've got some time. I'll do a little show later. And that's why I don't do the YouTube ones. The other thing is, now that I've steadied the camera on my wall, so I can bang this now and it barely shakes, right? The only thing is, to make it steady, I've had to pull a shelf right the way forward. Underneath that shelf is the camera that I used to use for the YouTube shows. Now, because that shelf's there, it's kind of cut off my head. So I need to do a couple of little experiments, really, to see if I can move that camera to a different place or maybe lower it a bit or something like that. And then we might be able to do YouTube as well as Facebook at the same time. You do get a full picture when we're doing it on YouTube live. I know when we're on Facebook, it's just a smaller picture in the middle, but that's how it works. If I was using Periscope, then you do get the full picture, but the messages come up over the screen and it's really off-putting. It's very difficult to sit here and do a chat while these messages are flashing up. And you just lose track of things. Because Facebook have split up the messages, so they're on the side and I'm in the middle, I can look straight at you, carry on doing a chat while the messages, and then come back to the messages later on, you see, as I do, all right? So that's the reason I haven't done it on YouTube, because the camera's now in the wrong place. But I'll try and fix that and we'll see what we can do. Got to say a big hello to Wayne Martin, who is another fellow karaoke host. Hello, Wayne. Nice to hear from you, sir. And let's see if we've got another couple of messages here. And then we'll do this other story. If you still want to ring in, you can do so, boys and girls. If you've got Skype, my Skype in is United Kingdom Talk. Ronan was talking on the Skype a little bit earlier, just a few moments ago, but unfortunately got cut off. Ronan, lovely for you to call in. Thank you very much. He's probably back with us now. Or you can call in on the phone, 020-8144-3477, okay? 020-8144-3477. Dino says, use a selfie stick and fix it somewhere, like it's sticking out like that. That would actually, that's not a bad idea. That's not a bad idea at all. And I tell you why, not just for here, because when I'm doing my karaoke shows, often it's a real problem finding where to put the camera. Now, If you've been to one of the karaoke live shows that we do here on Facebook now, then you'll see it. So it's a reasonable picture. It's a reasonable picture. I try to find where to put the camera. Often, the camera is literally held up with bits of, not sticky tape, that I'll show you. Hang on. This. It's often held up with gaffer tape, this stuff, which is really sticky. Very, very sticky. You don't really want to... There are varying different stickinesses of this sort of thing. But if you're only using it for half hour, you can generally attach it to the screen like that. And you obviously, you can't see that. But it is literally held up on walls. One was on the wall. Literally taped flat to the wall right in front of the host. Right in front of the singers. In the central station, it's actually attached to the top of like a wooden thing, and it's angled. So how can I do something with it? Look, like, so this calculator, so it's like on the shelf. Can you see that? You can't see that there, can you? And it, not only is it on a shelf, it's angled down and slightly round. And that's really how it works. With a selfie stick, I could just really attach that to something somehow. That's not a bad idea at all, actually, Craig, Dino. Thanks very much. Adam says, been tuned in for the past... Craig. Hello, Craig. Craig does hospital radio in Hinckley. Hello, Craig. He's been with us for 30 minutes as well. Thank you very much. Mandy says, there can be gaffs tape. What's gaffs tape? Gaffs tape. So I might have a look at that selfie sticks and have a little go with that, okay? 020-8144-3477 if you want to give us a call. We're around for about another 25 minutes or so, boys and girls. Okay. Now I've just got to read you this little story that's just appeared on the Daily Mail online that I saw just before I started the show today. Hello, Ian. Welcome along to the show, Ian. You're a bit late, Ian. Oh dear, we've been going for ages, mate, ages. And in the mail today, it says Kay Burley. Now, Kay Burley is one of the newsreaders on Sky News. Now, presumably, she's got her fans. But quite honestly, when she's talking to the camera, she is as cold as ice. You know, if you've ever known someone who's got depression, proper depression, not someone who's a bit unhappy, proper depression, and you don't get anything back, okay? I have experienced this with someone close many years ago, and you're talking to them and their eyes are just, there's nothing there, okay? It's like they're just looking like, and there's nothing coming back. When Kay Burley reads the news, they are just like that. She has no express... Thank you, Dino. She has no expression. It. Thank you, Mandy. Please keep that between us, Mandy. Thank you, that comment. Hello, Daniel. You're with us very late today. In my humble opinion, and remember, I'm not a professional at all. I'm not on the television. I'm just this bloke who sits here like this and chats away to you now and again. But in my humble opinion, Kay Burley should not be reading the news. Some of the muck-ups she had are unbelievable when she's been interviewing people with complete, like, no compassion. That's it. That's the word I'm looking for. No compassion whatsoever. I wouldn't want Kay Burley to be holding my hand doing an operation or something like that. There is no compassion at all when she's reading the news. And when she's talking to me, she comes across like she feels like she's above everyone. Completely opposite to the lovely, I don't know if you've watched her, and she's on every morning on BBC News 20, it's not called that anymore, is it? On the BBC News channel. There's a lady on there called Victoria Derbyshire, who comes across as mum. She comes across as mum, and she recently had, I think, a chemotherapy for breast cancer. And she allowed the cameras to follow her through this journey in the hospital and all that. And I won't forget, it was a couple of weeks ago, she'd had her last chemo thing and she took her hat on. She's talking to the camera, she just burst into tears. And that's, you know, you can relate you can relate to that person. She just had heart. You could feel it. Whereas when you watch Kay Burley, it's like watching, you might as well have a robot reading the news. There is no, there's just nothing there. Nothing there at all. Mandy says, masked expression. Yes, masked expression. Daniel says, she's just rude. She's very rude. Kay Burley is very rude. I don't know why she's on that channel. She must have a lot of viewers. Otherwise, she wouldn't be on there. Commercial television, which Sky is, you know, is run by the amount of viewers and amount of advertising. Presumably, she must have a lot of viewers. Anyway, in the Mail, she says, Kay Burley has found herself at the centre of a Twitter storm after complaints that she wasn't allowed to finish a £130 bottle of wine at celebrity haunt restaurant Chilton Firehouse. You can just imagine what sort of place that is, can't you? Yeah, you wouldn't get stars. I bet you wouldn't get stars there. When I say stars, Barry Manilow, Neil Diamond, Tina Turner, Shirley Bassey, they are stars. What you'd get is people who think they're stars, but are in fact just celebrities. Celebrities like Kay Burley. The Sky News presenter took to... I'll never forget, actually, she was on LBC for a while. And a friend of mine does a show on there, Steve Allen. I say a friend of mine, he kind of knows me and I know him. We've only met once in a garden centre by accident. Lovely, wonderful man. And he speaks as he feels. He says exactly what he feels. And that's why we love him. We love Steve Allen on LBC. Anyway, Kay Burley was on there for a while. And I think she was on after him or the other way around. And they would have like this changeover chat that some DJs do, or radio presenters. They're not DJs, they're radio presenters. Some radio presenters. Hello, Chris. Chris Moses is with us. Hello, Chris. Dino says she has the most viewers. Yummy mummies. Is that right? Is that right? Sorry, I've lost it there. Where did I lose it? I was looking at the messages. Shouldn't have done that. Where was I going with that? Kay Burley. That's a mistake, looking at the messages. All right, let's go back to this. So they paid £130. She tweeted, we paid £130. I've got it now. Okay, so on the changeover, Kay and Steve would talk to each other. And Steve would say something. And it was like Kay Burley didn't know what to say. Or even though you couldn't see her face and the eyes, you know, those eyes, those piercing eyes that she's got on Sky News, even though that, it's still, when she spoke after Steve spoke to her and he kept buying her presents, I don't know why, and she would buy him presents as well. And when she spoke, it was like she didn't know what to say. You know? Again, nothing in her voice. It was like just going through the motions. There was nothing in the voice at all. She tweeted, we paid £130. This is the story. Paid £130 for a bottle of average wine with dinner, but weren't allowed to finish it at the table and no space at the bar. I mean, was the place about to close? I don't think we've been given all the information here. And people quickly attacked her on Twitter for her stupid comments. This girl wrote, Sarah on Twitter wrote, £130 for a bottle of wine. Was it made of gold? And Anna Day wrote, sadness in your eyes, in a reference to the time she was lampooned after tweeting a now infamous photo of an apparently sad looking dog following the Paris attacks. And she's got no idea at all. No idea. And she's been on Sky News for years. How is she, man? How is it? I'm not being funny, right? I don't feel, I'm not asking you to, please don't come back with, oh, you're great and all that business, right? I've never felt I'm very good at doing what I do. And that goes for everything. I've got a bit of a self, I attack myself. I know you probably find that hard to believe, but I do have quite a low opinion of myself. But I watch Sky, people like Kay Burley on the telly. People like a lot of people on ITV, the Real Housewives programmes. Okay? Big Brother. The Only Way is Essex. I look at these people and I thought, how on earth have you managed to get on the telly and no one's ever offered me a job? Not that I've ever gone for it. I've never sent a demo. I've never done anything. Or I think I sent two demos. One to LBC years ago. I sent a little demo to LBC. No reply. Surprise, surprise. They don't bother replying. And I think possibly a music radio station. Again, they didn't reply. Okay. And I didn't bother anymore. I know I only sent two off. Now, people on the radio send hundreds and hundreds of demos out. I did do a radio show once. I did an overnight show on Liberty Radio, which was on the medium wave in London, 1999 to 2000. I got that job, right place at right time. People said, you're interested in doing radio, only they need an overnight show. Oh, yeah. And I jumped at the chance. Me and my friend David Rosen, who was also a DJ at the Black Cat, and we both did this job. It was for 6 weeks, but we ended up being there about a year and a half, after which time they replaced the night staff with computers, which is quite normal now for radio. And really, at night times, it was a wonderful little job because they just left us alone. No management or anyone really bothered us at night, you know. We're in radio terms, the top show is the breakfast show, the bottom show is the overnight show. So I was on the overnight show. They just used to leave us alone. I used to open the phone lines. People used to ring in. And it was wonderful, wonderful little job, really. I used to read out, just like, talk, obviously not as much talking as now. Quite honestly, I don't know how I managed to squeeze any records. But you had to play a certain amount of songs. It was quite a lot of songs. And you could only speak for like a couple of minutes at a time. And then you'd have to play another song all the time. Which was all right. Now, the thing is, if I was to apply for a job at Heart Radio or something like that, and radio, I know radio presenters, and I've said to them all, you know, and some of them indeed watch this and listen to the stuff that I do, and they've said to me, Chris, if you ever got a job in independent radio, you'd soon be really fed up with it because you don't have any freedom. You'd have to be very careful what you said. You know, I couldn't, for example, say, you know, I got this mug from Sports Direct. I would then have to say something to you like, you can buy other mugs are available from other shops. Oh, what a load of old crap. Why do you have to say that? You know, I get my mugs from Sports Direct. Why do I need to say you can get mugs from any? As if people are stupid enough to believe that you can only buy mugs from Sports Direct. You know, you can buy them from 101 places. John Lewis would be my favourite. Or Waitrose. You know, you can get them from Aldi. You can get them from Asda. You can get mugs from everywhere. I don't need to tell you other shops are available. But if I was doing a show on the talk radio, on a music radio station, I would have to say that. I'd also have like 30 seconds to talk to you. I'll be able to say something for 30 seconds, then we have to play another song. You have to be careful how you read news stories and all that. And I just don't think it's for me. I don't think it's for me. I have been listening to a new talk station that I've found. Talk radio. It's on the internet. You will find it. If you just type in talkradio.co.uk. And I do believe it's on one of the DAB things. I don't know if it's national, talk radio, if it's on DAB national, or if it is, whether it's available everywhere. I think it's in London on DAB Plus. Now, what is DAB Plus? Well, it's like the next level of DAB, which means if you've got a DAB radio, you probably won't be able to get it. It just gets madder and madder and madder, doesn't it? They bring out new things and no one's got one to listen on. How stupid is that? Never mind. Anyway, and so that's why I've never really applied, just because I was knocked back twice. So I didn't bother after that. But I do see these people on the telly and listen to people on the radio. And I'm like, how on earth have you got a job? And they've got a job. They've got a job because they are willing to fit in with the format of whatever it is. Now, if someone came along and said, Chris, we'd like you to come and do a music show. Or a chat show or something like that. You've got as much freedom as you want, but you can't do this, this and this. I probably could do that. And I'd probably be happy doing that. But I don't think, you know, I'd want to do this. What you're seeing and listening to now is me. There's no one here telling me what to say. You're probably very aware. If you know me, you will know my mouth is a bit, you know, naughty sometimes. Not on here. Because I know you don't want to hear me start swearing or turning the air blue. Why would you want to watch that? Huh? And maybe I keep certain views that I think, oh, that might upset a few people. You know, I probably wouldn't talk about those certain views. There's a couple going around in my head now. But I know some of you wouldn't like that. So I'll keep them to myself. And I think a lot of, not just radio and TV stations, a lot of companies want to be sort of in control of you. And it's a bit difficult to control me once, really. It is. Ben says you just speak your mind. Yeah, Colin says you just speak your mind. Well, I think I do, yeah. I think there's certain things that you wouldn't want to hear me say. And I certainly wouldn't swear. I try not to swear. Now, I do sometimes throw in what might be classed as a swear word now and again. But in the contents I give it to you, I don't think you can take it as a swear word. For example, let me give you an example. Yes, I saw... Okay, let's just pull a name out of the hat. Yeah, I saw Joey. I hope you don't mind. I'm going to use your name. Yeah, I saw Joey the other day online. Oh, he looked so pissed. It was unbelievable. Now, you could say pissed is a swear word, right? But in the context I've used it there, I don't think it's offensive. I really don't. So I think it's acceptable to use that. Now, a radio station might say, okay, Chris, but please don't swear. No problem at all. So Joey was really drunk the other night. I would just do it like that. But I do it without really thinking about it. I find it difficult not to swear when I'm out and about. And yet, I've sat here now for nearly an hour and a half. I haven't sworn once. I haven't thought about not swearing. It's just kind of automatic. Isn't it? You see what I mean? Hello to Mark. Mark is a vegan. Fabulous. Mark is a fully paid up vegan. And I praise you for that, Mark. Not that you need it. You don't need it, do you, darling? I praise you for that. Now, let's just go back to this story then. So Kay Burley goes on and people went on. As the abuse flooded in, goes the story. As the abuse flooded in, Kay, evidently in fighting mood, reeled off a series of comebacks. She told one troll to watch his potty mouth. And after anonymous Twitter branded her pond life vermin, an elitist shite hawk, she replied, "We have a winner, ladies and gentlemen." she's just awful. Why would you want to tell people that you just... Ash, have you just joined us? Hang on a minute. You were there earlier and then disappeared. Where did you go? We're nearly finished now, mate. Only 7 minutes left. That's Kay Burley there. And I just do not rate her as a news reader. I really don't. She upsets a lot of people. Now, newsreaders of the past. How many of these do you remember? The great Angela Rippon. Angela Rippon, you remember her? These are all newsreaders from my past, some of my favourites. I wrote them down. Richard Bacon, Gordon Honeycomb with the bald head. He used to do the ITN news. Victoria Derbyshire, she's on every mornings, I think 9:15 in the morning on the BBC News Channel. There is a guy on the News Channel, I'm going to say some of these names. You probably won't know them, but you'd know them to look at. Simon McCoy. Now, he's like your dad. He's like your dad reading the news. And he's like your dad because he keeps trying to make funny joke and they just don't work. Every time he says something funny, and often the presenter sitting next to him kind of looks at him. Why did you say that? I mean, don't get me wrong. Don't dislike him. I think he's great. Simon McCoy. But he does these jokes. And the funny thing is that they are funny because they're not funny. Do you know what I mean? They're funny because they're not funny. So he's like the dad who tries to be funny. Maxine Mawinney. I quite like her. I think she's the blonde. Isn't she the blonde girl? Maxine Mawinney. Like her. One of my favourites of all time was Moira Stewart. I think she was the first black lady newsreader we had in the UK. And she was around for years. Wonderful, wonderful newsreader. One of my favourites. Philip Hayton, the lovely Jill Dando, of course, who was murdered, wasn't it? Because of her involvement on the BBC's Crime Watch programme. Sue Lawley, don't know if you remember her. She used to also host Nationwide. She's 70s, 80s Sue Lawley. Lovely lady. And I think it's a toss-up for me between these two ladies. Either Moira Stewart is my favourite one of all time, or Jan Leeming. Who remembers Jan Leeming? She was really prim and proper. And she was recently on Celebrity Jungle thing on ITV or something like that. Hello, Mary. All right, Mary. She was really good, Jan Leeming. And she also, I don't know if you remember, hosted the Eurovision Song Contest in 1982, although she had this band thing around, like clothes that she was wearing. And she had this band thing around her head, and I don't know who advised her to put that on, but it just looked awful. Awful. So they're my favourite newsreaders. Perhaps you've got some favourite newsreaders. Type them in underneath here. We've only got about 4 minutes left now, boys and girls, before we have to go, because we're limited to an hour and a half on the Facebook Live, okay? Wendy says Angela Rippon was awesome. She was. Do you remember that time her earring dropped off? She was reading the 9 o'clock news. The 9 o'clock news from the BBC with Angela Rippon. And it always went like that. Wonderful graphics. And her earring dropped off. Well, it was on the front page of the bloody papers the next day. God's sake. They must have been desperate for stories. So thanks. Ash, Trevor Mack. Oh, is that the black guy on ITN? Trevor McDonald? Trevor McDonald, let me tell you a story. I fixed his telephone. I met him, knocked on the door. Trevor McDonald opens the doors. Lovely man. Lovely man. Not really very jokey. He was quite serious, but decent man. Decent man, yeah. Liked him. Let's have a look. Dino says Eamon Holmes is now on Talk Radio. Yes, he's one of the... Is he on there now? I know he's on there. Also, Ian... Oh, God, what's his name? Ian, oh, there's a guy called Ian on there, a youngish guy who I never used to like, but I've heard him on there and he's not too bad now. Ian something or other, can't remember his name now. He's all right on there, actually. Dina says, no idea how Christo gets on. Christo on LBC, oh, horrendous. 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 He just keeps going on about the fact that he's not religious and the whole gay issue thing. Keeps going on about gay things all the time, which, you know, why? I don't know why... go on and on about gay things and religion, you know. Oh, I'm not, and there's a lot of them on there that do that. I'm not religious, but well, why are you telling, we don't want to know. Why are you telling us that? We're not really interested in that. Daniel says, apart from my dress sense, fantastic today. What do you mean? There's nothing wrong with my dress. I've put this lovely Ralph Lauren jacket. This is 250 quid, this bloody jacket I've worn for you today. How rude you are. Mandy says, you've got self-esteem issues. Yes, indeed, I have. I have got self-esteem issues, I'm afraid. Mandy also says, my grandma would say starched knickers. To what? Starched knickers. All right. So there we are. I think we're going to disappear in a second, boys and girls. Just do two more messages at the top there. Wendy says, I remember... Oh, yes. Morecambe and Wise, old, what's her name? Angela Rippon was on Morecambe and Wise. And she started off reading the news. And she said, and here is the news. And then she went, when there's moonlight and love and romance, let's face some music. And then the desk opened up, Morecambe and Wise appeared, and she'd done this whole dance routine with them, which was really good. Ben Colin also says, Moira Stewart was a great newsreader. Jan Leeming was great too. Jan Leeming used to be the Christmas newsreader. I don't know if you remember. I think she did 7 Christmases in a row. She really did. That's it. All right, boys and girls, I'm going to disappear now. I've actually got all these stories lined up in front of me. I was thinking of doing sort of a newspaper show in the mornings. I don't know what you think about that, where we just have a little bit of a chat like this and do some newspaper stuff in the mornings. I don't know how many people would be around for that. We might try it one morning, okay? Anyway, thank you very much. It's just coming up to, look at that, just coming up to 12:30 on Thursday, March the 31st, 2015. Thank you very much. If you missed any of this and you want to watch it back again, it will go up. The whole thing will go back up. I don't know how long that takes. Have a lovely, lovely evening, all right? Thanks for joining me. Ta-ra now.